Hello and welcome. My name is Nadir Akhtar.
And I'm Saroj Chintakrindi.
And today we'll be your hosts through the week one FAQ. I'm the president of Blockchain at Berkeley, and I've been helping teach this course for about the last year. After revamping the Blockchain Fundamentals course that we teach on campus, I've had the honor of helping port this material over to edX for all you wonderful students to see.
And I'm the vice president of Blockchain at Berkeley, and I've been involved with the blockchain for about a year and a half now through consulting, R&D, and now education, working on teaching blockchain to a wider audience. Question one, how does Bitcoin have value?
Well, you see, Bitcoin has value the same way that anything else has value, like the dollar bill or gold. Someone saw this shiny piece of rock and said, hey, I want that. And someone else saw that shiny piece of rock and said, I want it too. And so these people, they spend resources trying to get that shiny piece of rock. The same thing with the dollar bill. One person wants it because they want to participate in the economy, and someone else says, I think this economy is valuable. I want to participate in it as well. So they spend more resources trying to get it. And Bitcoin's the same thing, except with math and protocol. Someone sees this decentralized platform and thinks, I want to be part of that. I want to be able to send money peer-to-peer on this decentralized payment system. And someone else says, well, I want to do it more. So they spend more money trying to get Bitcoin. And eventually all ties down to speculation that everything has value because people believe it has value. But as to why Bitcoin specifically has value is because of the math, the protocol, and the potential that its value will go up in the future. So people want it for several reasons, but those are the most popular ones. Second question, Saroj. What are cypherpunks and crypto-anarchists, and what exactly is the difference?
Great question. So in the early 1990s, a computer scientist from UC Berkeley wrote the Cypherpunk Manifesto. And the idea of the Cypherpunk Manifesto was that people should be able to control their own identity and their own personal information using cryptography. Through encryption and decryption, one should be able to selectively reveal their information. For example, if I were a cypherpunk, I would believe that I could conceal my birthday or my bank account information, I could encrypt it and only decrypt it when I wish to reveal it to whoever I choose to. Crypto-anarchists are similar, and some would say they might be a subset of cypherpunk. They extend the idea of concealing and revealing information to using cryptography to run governments and community protocols and peer-to-peer transaction systems. Next question. Why does proof-of-work consume so much energy? Isn't this a design flaw?
Right. Well, that's a good question. Well, proof-of-work consumes a lot of energy because that's the resource that keeps voting power scarce. If there wasn't a scarce voting resource, then anyone could civil attack, where they could create a million, billion, so on, identities and vote as many times as they wanted. And energy, or this ability of computational power, is the most abundant resource in this network, because everyone's running a machine, a Bitcoin node, and therefore has access to a machine. And since this is available all around the world, it was something that could easily make for this decentralized payment mechanism. As to whether it's a design flaw, that's a deeper of a debate. A lot of people say that it's not a design flaw, that it's a necessary evil because of the way that consensus needs to happen. And other people say that there are other ways to make consensus happen, like proof of stake. Proof of stake uses instead financial capital to make sure that consensus happens correctly by saying that everyone needs to stake some amount of, let's say, Bitcoin, and by that, they could then have voting power. So it all depends on maintaining a scarce resource and making sure that voting is able to happen through some consensus mechanism. So Saroj, tell me, what are some of the differences between Bitcoin private keys, public keys, and addresses?
Great question. You've probably seen these terms lying around and you're probably wondering what they are, and we'll go more into detail in lecture 3, but let me give you a little teaser for now. Private keys are a random 256-bit number that's used to lock up your Bitcoin. You can't send anyone your Bitcoin if you don't have the private key. Public keys are a 256-bit number generated from the private key that's used to identify you and to identify the Bitcoin. Finally, addresses are a 160-bit number generated from the public key that's used to add another layer of privacy to make it a little bit harder to identify you. So what happens if one person has more than one CP to vote with? And what's a 51% attack?
Well, those are two very good questions, Saroj. So first, if one person has more than one CP to vote with, the answer is very simple. They have more voting power. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. If a person is willing to put up more electricity, more capital, and more resources in order to vote, that means that they deserve more rewards. Now, the issue is when that person gets too much computational power. If that person has more than the rest of the network, then they can launch what's known as a 51% attack. This could be a person, group, or other entity that has a majority of the network computational power. And when that happens, they can determine which transactions get included within the blockchain and censor transactions that they don't like. We'll go into this more in depth in the game theory lecture, but for now, understand that a 51% attack essentially lets you make the longest chain at all times. It lets you make the one that's recognized by everyone else because no one can produce blocks as fast as you can. Saroj, I have a problem. Well, I have a question and a problem. I found 50 Bitcoin in my couch last weekend and I don't know what to do with it. So can you tell me, how do I spend Bitcoin?
Sure. So when you spend Bitcoin, you're usually going to use a wallet, which is a device or a piece of software that stores your private keys for you. And when you want to send your transaction, there are a few steps you have to go through. So the first one is to specify the address that you want to set it to. And you have to double check this, or even triple check, because if your address is wrong, then there's no way to reverse your transaction. The second step is to specify the transaction fees that you want to include as part of your transaction. Transaction fees are basically incentive for miners to verify your transaction. And a high transaction fee means that more miners want to verify your transaction, and a low one means that it's going to take a while for your transaction to get verified. And finally, after you send your transaction, you're going to have to wait for a few confirmations. And a confirmation is essentially a block that's mined on top of the block that includes the transaction that you just sent. Standard practice is to wait for about 6 or so confirmations to be considered valid, but that depends on your needs. So I've heard about quantum computing in the news as up-and-coming technology. Will this hurt or kill Bitcoin?
Well, Saroj, the quick answer is no, it will not hurt nor kill Bitcoin, and here's why. First, quantum computers aren't going to undo the cryptography of Bitcoin. Now, granted, quantum computers would be good at some problems, but they're not good at everything. They're not better than classical computers at every problem. One example where they are better is public keys and private keys. Quantum computers can efficiently undo public keys into private keys. So that's something that classical computers cannot do easily. So if someone has your public key, they can easily get your private key. The difference between quantum computers being able to take all your Bitcoin and the reality is that Bitcoin, as we mentioned earlier, aren't shared with public keys. Instead, they're shared with addresses. So only when you're redeeming Bitcoin is your public key revealed. When you're receiving Bitcoin, it's your address that you share. And quantum computers cannot reverse addresses to public keys easily. And this is something we'll talk about more in the later lectures. As for when it comes to proof of work, as to whether quantum computers will give someone more advantage when it comes to voting power, the answer still is no. Currently, the cost of getting a quantum computer working efficiently is much more expensive than a classical computer. So the ratio of voting power slash computational power to the cost of getting it is actually not that great. And in the future, 20 years from now, if quantum computers become regularly accessible, then that levels out the playing field for everyone. And again, it's not a concern. Saroj, my last question for you. Is Bitcoin anonymous? And if not, what are some best privacy practices?
The answer is, sort of. It's important to realize that privacy isn't a binary yes or no, it's a spectrum. And in Bitcoin, it's something we call pseudonymous. By default, all the transactions on Bitcoin are public, and you can view any of them. But all you see for identities are a bunch of addresses. You don't know who anyone is. You don't know what their personal identities are. So if I were to put my Bitcoin address on a public forum, suddenly I've connected my address with my personal identity, and anyone can follow my transactions, and it becomes very much less private. And there are a few ways to get around this. Two solutions include coin mixing and coin tumbling, but since it's such a technical topic, we'll be putting this off until our second course is launched in September.